Welcome back. My name is Nicholas Wasaja, and you're still watching The Checkpoint. Today, our guest is Justice James Ogola, the chairperson, Elders Council Uganda, or the Elders Forum Uganda. My lord, when we broke off you had told us that elective politics is not made for you. But one of the key things that has come up time and again in these governance discussions has been the fact that it seems the elites, the educated, the well-refined characters of this society have left the politics to the other people, and that is why the politics is messy.
I don't know if you're right or wrong. I hope you're wrong. But there may be people who think the way that you think. What we need to do, though, is not worry about what people think, is to worry and do something about the politics. If indeed politics is dirty, then we should do something about it. My own idea is, why are people so engrossed in the idea of becoming an MP? I think the simple answer could be that because, as I said before, the prize which they perceive they will get at the end of the struggle is so glamorous. And what is that prize? The money. If you're looking at 100 million Uganda shillings per month as your take home from becoming a member of parliament, that's a very big something to entice people to go for it. What we could do, therefore, to bring sanity into politics is to do something about that money. There is over-concentration of money in the politicking of today. What you get out of it and what you invest into it. We can and we should and we must do something about that. We should have legislation or reforms around that area so that we don't make it so glamorous for somebody to hunger for it so much, but at the same time, we make it something that is noble. So those who go there know that you are going for service rather than for money. And I think that kind of legislation and its implementation is not beyond the genius of Uganda today. We also have something that Kenya brought in recently. We could be thinking about that. Part of the reason people want to be MPs is probably money, but others have so much money anyway that they are looking for power. How do they get that power? They get to be appointed ministers. They join the executive club of Uganda. Now we could again do something about that one. We could think, let's do research about it. Let's think deeply about whether the Kenyan example is working. The Kenyan example is that ministers in the cabinet at the executive table are appointed from outside parliament. So if that was one enticing factor for people to do die or leave to become an MP so that you can become a cabinet minister, maybe we could do something about that.
But my lord, you see, Kenya has just a handful of ministers. You're talking about people in Uganda that are clamoring to be in power if they do not need the money. How many of these are you going to accommodate?
I think that one has also added insult to injury. The constitutional setup, right from the independence of this country, was never that one third of the parliament could become executives in terms of ministers. The numbers that we now have do not encourage the kind of thing that I'm talking about. We should have a handful. Why not? Go to every other country on this planet. Cabinets are small, but the civil service is the one who should do the job. the numbers by themselves in a ministry do not do the job. What does the job are the professional civil servants in that ministry. The cabinet member in a ministry gives political direction to the people who are doing the actual job. And that's not, again, beyond remedy. I think we can revisit that issue and see what numbers are optimal for doing the job in Uganda today. I think everybody agrees that the numbers that we now have are beyond what is optimal.
My lord, going back to the money question, how are you going to be able to bring down the colossal amounts of money that our representatives take home if they are the ones that make the laws that set the money bar high?
First and foremost, let the laws, the legal structure, infrastructure on this be looked at very carefully. How come the parliament is able to determine its own remuneration? Does the law give it that authority? Maybe it does. So let's go back to the basics and ask, is that law okay? Should we revisit it or not? How about other public servants in this country who don't make their own salary? How about the, I think there's a salaries commission?
Salaries review commission.
Salaries review commission. What is its role in all of this? Is it still making contribution to this debate? What I'm saying really is that it's not me to provide the solutions. What I'm saying is that let the people of Uganda sit, maybe in this dialogue format, maybe in another conversation format, and revisit these issues and see if they can add value to this whole idea of deflating the political abuse that we are beginning to see in this country and make it more noble so that it can entice people that you call the noble people to come on board and serve the nation.
One of the key issues that comes out, for example, giving comparisons, when you, for example, look at the Odochi Commission, one would say it was really a people dialogue. People went out there to talk to the people. But it seems, for example, if you're talking about the national dialogue, it seems like it is elitist and all that. Probably that is at the bedrock of why it didn't even take off.
It may be perceived as elitist, but it's far from being elitist. We have had in its formation, in its concept, we have gone to every part of this country to visit at local levels, at Gombolola levels, at SAZA levels, to engage with the people. We did that as one of the last efforts on this crusade. We went to Lira, we went to Gulu, we went to Busia, we went to the west, we went to the north, we went here in the center, meeting with the people at district level, at SAZA level, at Gombolola level. We had people come here in Kampala at that levels. We have met with the professions. We've met with the women. We've met with the youth. I told you about how we met with the youth in the east at Soroti a couple of years back. And there were about 400 youth out there from all over the place. We've met with the students. We've met with the guild presidents of universities. We've met with vice chancellors, organizations. We met with the workers, we met with everybody in this country to get the seed planted, the seed of dialogue. And then, that's not the end of it. That was to sensitize the population. But the actual dialogue will be filtered from the people. These same people that we've been talking to are the ones that would send representatives once we agree the numbers and the venue and what have you. In fact, the national dialogue will take two levels. One, a national one here in Kampala, at the capital, or in the regional capitals. So those people can also have a bite at what is going on. So it's far from being elitist.
My lord, should dialogue be about only the politics of the country, the governance and politics of the country? Because for some, there are even more pressing issues like their livelihoods that should be coming at the center.
Indeed, indeed. The way we have designed, the way we had designed this dialogue, politics was the last of the many, many, many items.
Maybe that's why the politicians
like
didn't
land,
support you.
Land is the most basic asset to any country, and especially so to a country like ours, which is still rural and agricultural. Land, and this commission that went around, I think has brought up the issues that come with the land. And we need a dialogue on that one. How do we hold this land? How do we register it? If there are issues, how do we solve them? Some of the land issues that go through our ordinary courts of law take a lifetime. Once you have a dispute, your father has a dispute with a neighbor or a brother or a friend, that dispute will take your father to the grave and you will inherit that problem and bring it all the way up to the Supreme Court of Uganda. That's the reality of land. Should it be like that? We have other issues. Values, the values of this nation. We don't want to take people back to pre-colonial times, but we must have values. Some of them are articulated in the Constitution. But now the idea of education, taking young ones away from parents, and parents being too busy to take care of the little ones, and living in an urban setting so that children are not brought up by the grandparents and the sengas and so on. That is a problem, and we need to address it nationally. The mere fact that we are now a conglomeration of all sorts of communities and nationalities in this one nation, that has brought up issues that we never had before. That should be brought to the table of dialogue. The fact that Uganda is is an island in this region, and that we depend so much on those who have coastlines, Tanzania and Kenya and so on, that's a big issue. So what should be our stand on international relationships and regional relationships? So there are so many issues, social, economic, land, and name them, and political is just one of these.
What you're explaining gives me the feeling that perhaps that's why this very noble cause did not get the political and will and support that it deserved. I'll give you an example. For example, if you talk about land, some of the land issues, the land crisis has been created by largely the political class. And you're putting them at the tail end of this process, and you're bringing the controversial issue of land where they will be put on the spot. When you talk about reconciliation of some of the things, the ills that we've omitted against each other, the politicians are at the center of this. So probably, don't you have a feeling you did not sieve through the whole political dynamics at play? That's why.
But you're absolutely right. Dialogue without controversy is no dialogue. If everything is dandy, then there's no need for dialogue. There has to be controversy. And you have put it very rightly. Land has got two camps. Those who benefit from abusing the systems that are here, and those who suffer from that abuse. The political, the electoral cases that we are talking about is the same thing. There are those who benefit and those who lose out. It's precisely because of those controversies that dialogue is the one thing that can come in. And we have to find a formula for that. But as long as the political class, as you put it, have got the upper hand, then you have to work around that and get your dialogue. Indeed, that's why we in IRCU, the Religious Council, and the Elders Forum of Uganda, we put as our captain in all this the issue of a citizens' dialogue, not a government dialogue. But let the citizens move this dialogue. Let them bring the pressure to bear on those who wield power in the state until the time that dialogue will be found. I'll give you one little example why I'm still hopeful. You were not there. I was there in the 1950s when this country struggled for independence to get the colonial yoke off our back. The colonial overlords had the power and the authority and the army and the guns and the money. It was like David fighting Goliath. But if David had given up at that time, would still be governed under the colonial dispensation today. But the little David said, no, I'll get my sling, I'll get a small rock, put it in there, and pull as much as I can and let go. And the colonial edifice came crumbling down. I'm hopeful that in this issue of dialogue, it will play out the same way. There will come a time when this nation will wake up and say, no, we have to sit at that table. Unfortunately, the cost may be too much, costing blood and lives and lost opportunities will be too much. The sooner we get to it, the better.
My Lord, I would say in comparison, when you look at the 1996 election, 2001, 2006, 2011, and then 2016 was less violent compared to the other elections.
Yes.
It's not to say that it wasn't violent,
yes,
but it was less violent. Would you attribute that to the presidential debate?
I would say that that did play a great part. It was controversial as an election, 2016. There were elements of violence. But what was even worse was the looming specter of even more violence to go the way that Kenya went in 2007. Post the election, it would have been mayhem. We came out and did two things. One, we went to the principal actors of the time, quietly, diplomatically, talked to each one of them, and it cooled tempers somehow. But two, just before and during the election, just before the election, we carried out that debate, the first of its kind in this country. And what the debate did was to bring all the contestants together, give them a platform, and say, you have manifestos, all of you. You have ideas, all of you, of where you want to take this country if you are elected. Tell the people of Uganda, here is an opportunity. We put you on the national television, on the national radio, on all the ways of talking to the people of Uganda. I think that time there were 40 or 30, whatever million there were. Tell the people of Uganda what you are going to do. And do so in a civil way. Bring out all the arguments. Bring out the hoopla. Take out the emotions. Speak sensibly and logically to the people of Uganda. That's what debates do. And indeed, the people of Uganda rose to the occasion and listened in, and they were hooked to their television sets and their radios, and they listened in and made their choice. One hopes and prays that that opportunity will come again. We are working behind the scenes to have a debate for these elections. The debate will be even more deep than the last one. We are thinking of a debate for the presidential elections, and we are thinking of debates for the parliamentary elections. The numbers are too huge. 500 of them is too many. We cannot pull that one off. But we want to do some piloting debates. Take some of the parliamentary, maybe five of them, maybe in each region. Take some pilot in the cities. Now we have cities, maybe all of them. Have those who want to be mayors debate the issues in their cities. And we feel that this is a fundamental value addition to the political exercise of electing representatives to lead them.
My lord, as we are winding up, I wouldn't want to refer to directly, but well, the NRM primaries have the results have been violent. We've so far 5 people dead. A minister is in prison. What's your take on what's playing out? Do you think there is hope that we can have a better election? Is there a chance to have a better general election compared to vis-a-vis to what is happening in the ruling party?
I'm not a pessimist. I am an optimist. I'm thinking that these were shortcomings for whatever reason in a mass party of this country, the biggest party in this country, represented everywhere, well-funded. But the results leave one with a very bad taste in the mouth. And however optimistic one is, it leaves one with the fear that the election of 2021 could be the worst election in our history so far. I don't want to think that way, but I think we should prepare ourselves. Everybody in this country should take this as a lesson and prepare ourselves, I don't know how, for the worst possible outcomes in 2021. I do not understand why in a party, this is an in-house exercise, a party which is well-funded. It has all the people. It has the electoral commission there, or of their own, the internal party elections commission. I do not know why the emotions came so much. And it was not in one place. It's more or less covering the entire landscape of the country. I don't know if it's peculiar or only in the party, there's some issues in there, because I take solace in another election that took place side by side with the NRM one, and that was the election of the presidency and the vice presidency and the executive of the Uganda Law Society. It took place, I believe, on last Friday. I did not hear of any violence there. I did not hear of any rigging in there. It was civility. It was professional. People were talking issues. There was a debate. I heard of a debate among the contestants. The results of the Uganda Law Society coming on the same day as the results of the NRM elections leave a big gap in the thinking of why mayhem happens in one and perfection, close to perfection, happens in the other. And these are the same people, the same Ugandans, pursuing the same ends of leadership, one of their own party, the other of their own society, law society. Same people, two different. The difference is like day and night. I don't know why.
My Lord, as...
It will not be enough to hope that things will right themselves in NRM. I think we will need prayers.
The Constitution talks of a regular, free, and fair election. That is the provision of the Constitution. But do you think, under the circumstance with COVID-19, and then the provision that we should have a scientific election, quote-unquote, or virtual election, do you think we are in position as a country to have a credible election as envisioned by the Constitution?
And finally, I have to say no. And I'm on record over these last 2-3 months as saying that given everything that is happening now and all the vindication that this primary election in the party has now brought to the table, that we find a way to postpone this election for another time. Why is it a question of life and death to hold this election? It's a question of life and death because we have seen the lines of people who come to vote do not respect the SOPs of the Ministry of Health. We have seen those who campaign are not doing it either scientifically or, as the Electoral Commission said, hybrid, which is half and half. They're not doing that. It's full throttle for the party elections. How much throttle will there be for the real real election of the presidency, the MPs, the local governments when it comes to 2021? The numbers on COVID are not encouraging any election to take place. The way the numbers are piling up on all sectors, the dead, the living, the afflicted, are indications that we should think twice about whether to risk the life of the nation for the sake of an election. It's said that the law requires that we must have an election. But the law is made by the people. We are the people. We can make another law. We can adjust that law. We can interpret that law in such a way that we find room to postpone, to reserve that election to a day when we feel it's right to do so.
My Lord, thank you very much for making time to the show.
Thank you.
We are really elated. Be sure to catch the checkpoint tomorrow, same time. Good night.